workshop. Okay. We're going to start by doing a body scan meditation, very short, just for 3 minutes. So please adopt the posture that you already know. Sit on the verge of your chairs. Backs upright, in upright position.
Preparada. Let's start with a brief mindful meditation practice to relax your body and focus your mind. You can do this guided meditation on your own, 3 to 6 days per week for 4 weeks. And so research suggests that people who practice the body scan for longer reap more benefits from this practice. The body scan can be performed while lying down, sitting, or in other postures. And this one is designed to be done while sitting. So close your eyes and let's start. Begin by bringing your attention into your body. You can close your eyes if that's comfortable for you. You can notice your body seated wherever you are seated, feeling the weight of your body on the chair, on the floor, wherever you're sitting. Take a few deep breaths. And as you take a deep breath, bring in more oxygen and lightening the body. And as you exhale, have a sense of relaxing more deeply. You can notice your feet on the floor. Notice the sensations of your feet touching the floor, the weight and pressure, vibration, heat. you can notice your legs against the chair, pressure, pulsing, heaviness, lightness. Notice your back against the chair. Now bring your attention into your stomach area. If your stomach is tense or tight, let it soften and take a breath. Notice your hands. Are your hands tense or tight? See if you can allow them to soften. Notice your arms. Feel any sensation in your arms. And let your shoulders be soft. Notice your neck and your throat. Let them be soft. Relax. Soften your jaw. Let your face and facial muscles be soft. Then notice your whole body present and take one more breath. Be aware of your whole body as best you can and take a breath. And then, when you are ready, you can open your eyes.
Good morning. Welcome back.
Okay, so welcome again to this workshop. As you can see on the first slide, the title of this workshop is Post Butterfly Posing, Active Listening, Emotions and Meditation in the Bilingual Classroom. And let me start by drawing your attention to the quote that you can see on this slide by Chuang Tzu, who is an Oriental wise man, an Oriental sage. As you probably know, the old in their knowing, ancient wise men,
knew that sometimes it was hard to draw a clear dividing line between the waking world and the world of dreams. So Chuang Tzu once said, "I dreamed I was a butterfly, fluttering hither and thither. Then I awoke. Now I wonder, am I a man who dreamed of being a butterfly, or am I a butterfly dreaming that I am a man?" That's a very puzzling story, as you can see. And in subsequent years, this story was revisited by other eminent men of letters, such as the Argentinian Jorge Luis Borges, who also wrote short stories about the same notion, the notion that at times is difficult to say where dreams end and where reality begins. Okay, why this title for this presentation? Why post butterflies posing? And I want you to pay attention to post and posed. These are different. They are quasi-homophones, but they are not. Well, a post butterfly stops flying for the fraction of a second. It sits on a flower petal, on a tree bough, or on a blade of grass to simply exist as it out of time for a while. Whereas a post butterfly is something different. A post butterfly is the term that we use to refer to a yoga posture, to a yoga asana. And well, we need to be post and posed at the same time to make the most of this experience in this workshop. So now forget about the world and just be present here and now. That's why we have started this session with a body scan meditation. Well, this is what we are going to do in today's workshop. Our goals, our objectives are three of them. The first one is to introduce you to active listening skills. Active listening is fundamental when it comes to doing mindfulness, when it comes to cultivating design thinking in a classroom. And it is of the essence in your everyday personal lives as well. So that's the first thing, active listening skills. The second objective is going to be to do a bit of meditation, different kinds of meditation practices. And the third goal has to do with time management. As you probably know, time is one of the main sources of stress in our everyday lives, because we always have an endless list of things to do every day. But our time is limited. Every day has just 24 hours, and we have to try and learn to make the most of them. So we'll look at different ways of making the most of time, and we'll introduce the concept of the time matrix. So those are the three objectives for this lesson. And of course, we'll be talking about emotions and emotion management. That was the luminous metaphor that I have tried to explain to you before. So what are emotions, and why are they important? Let's have a look at these three different definitions that we have come across in different dictionaries. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, an emotion is an instinctive or intuitive feeling as distinguished from reasoning or knowledge. According to the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, an emotion is a conscious mental reaction subjectively experienced, a strong feeling usually directed toward a specific object and typically accompanied by physiological and behavioral changes in the body. And the last definition is a composite definition, drawing on a number of definitions that we have come across in different sources. Emotions are responses to significant internal and external events. They are usually brief in duration and consist of a coordinated set of responses, which may include verbal, physiological, behavioral,
and neural mechanisms. Well, emotions, as you probably know as well, are different from feelings, from moods, and from effects. We're not going to go into these details, but you should know that they are not the same. Feelings are something completely different. Feelings are a subjective representation, cultural representation of emotions as experienced by an individual. But interestingly enough, the word emotion is very curious. It goes back in time, according to some experts on emotion research, to the very origins of language, human languages. And actually, you find the word emotion in lots of different languages across the world, and it looks almost the same. The first appearance of the word as such happened in the 16th century in French. But if you look at the root, at the etymology of the word, emotion comes from the Latin e mobere, which means to move outside. So it is as if you were projecting certain states of mind outside of yourself towards the world. Why are emotions important? Well, basically, they are a survival mechanism, and we need them. Which are the universal emotions? Can you name them? Happiness, is it a universal emotion? Sadness, anger, fear. Is love a universal emotion or is it a feeling? Could be both. Well, there's no consensus amongst researchers, but love is not one of the basic universal emotions. Sorry, the other way. Those are the seven basic emotions. So we have mentioned some of them already: happiness, sadness, anger, fear, surprise, disgust, asco. That's universal as well. And some scholars at a seventh universal emotion, which is contempt, desprecio. There's a very interesting scholar by the name of Paul Ekman. He has been doing research on emotions for over 40 years. And one of his most important findings is that people all over the world, regardless of their linguistic or cultural background, can recognize these seven emotions. Even in pre-literate societies, in societies where people have not been exposed to the media or to writing, people can recognize these seven emotions in other people, in other people's faces, facial expression. That's very curious. And well, he did very intensive research in Papua Guinea, New Guinea, and he found out that people can recognize them straight away, right? A few years later, 1986, this man, Robert Plotnik, came up with the Wheel of Emotions. Well, according to Plotnik, there are eight universal emotions, and he decided to group them on a positive or negative basis. He said there are four pairs of emotions: joy versus sadness, anger versus fear, trust versus disgust, and surprise versus anticipation. But have a closer look at this wheel of emotions. If you pay attention to this wheel, you will realize that emotions exist on a sort of continuum of intensity. So for example, look at rage. Anger is the universal emotion, but in much the same way you combine primary colors to produce secondary colors, you can combine primary emotions to produce or to make more complex emotions. So you've got anger, rage, which in terms of intensity is, you know, much stronger, and then you've got annoyance. So the same applies to all eight basic emotions according to Plotnik. Just have a look at this wheel again and try to position yourself within this wheel of emotions. How do you feel right now? Are you experiencing joy or serenity? Just talk to your partner for 1 minute. Where do you position yourselves within the wheel of emotions? Talk to your partner. Right now, yes.
Pero interesante. Ven, claro.
Why don't we take another breath together? Is it okay with you? Okay? Let's sit in the meditation position. Okay. We are going to breathe together in the group. This is a way of taking everybody's in. So if you're in class, it is a way of fostering the feeling of belonging to the group. So I really recommend you to use this activity whenever you're in class and students are tired, nervous, they feel unease. So when they are in an unease situation or feeling nervous or they're not able to connect, bring them together just by asking them to sit, putting their feet on the floor, staying in upright position, and then why don't you try to say good morning to everyone just by looking at people. So I look at people and don't say anything, just look. I pass my eyes through everybody's faces, I look at them, and then I close my eyes. And when you close your eyes, you put your hands in your lap. You feel your body sitting right here in this moment, trying to bring your mind, which may be wandering away, moving far away, jumping from one thought to the other, in a monkey fashion. Our monkey mind is going up, going down, jumping here, going there. But we find it is doing that, and we bring it back to our breathing, and to our body, and to our present moment. Now, together, I want to invite you to wish a very good morning to everybody by taking one deep breath. Are you ready? Inhale. Good morning, guys. Exhale. Good morning, guys. How are you today? One more time. Inhale. Good morning. How are you today? Exhale. You can now open your eyes. Smile. Good morning. Okay. Now, look. When we talk about emotions, we cannot talk about emotions from here. We cannot use our minds to talk about emotions, because emotions are not here. If we talk about emotions from here, not from here, we are not doing anything. So, by asking you, as we did, in which emotion are you today? You would start thinking, well, I am. So your monkey mind goes crazy trying to find a nice word to say. Today I'm happy. Today I'm bored. So we start mixing up emotions, feelings, moods. My partner, my colleague, she has just explained to you this list of emotions which are said to be universal. These emotions are universal. And for example, Ekman and also the other scholar, I don't remember his name, they were trying to explain all these emotions. When we distinguish between a good emotion and a bad emotion, we're making a mistake. Do you believe that emotions are either good or bad? They are not. All of them are necessary. All of them. Why then do you think that we say that emotions are good or bad? Because of which feeling? So you're having an emotion, and where do you feel emotions? You feel emotions in your bodies. Which is the difference between an emotion and a feeling? An emotion is universal and it is felt in your body. A feeling appears when we humans develop language. So some feelings exist in some languages, but not in others. So these feelings are cultural, but emotions are universal. When we talk about good and bad, do you remember that we were saying that we have to adopt a beginner's mind? A beginner's mind means that we should try to avoid attaching to things because they are really pleasant, or saying no to things because they are unpleasant. Don't you remember when we were saying, be with the unpleasant, be with the pleasant, trying to adopt perspective? Well, when we have unpleasant feelings, these feelings are associated with those emotions that we call bad emotions. They are not bad. They are absolutely necessary to survival. Humans need emotions. We are now going to play a short video clip from a very, very interesting film that we believe that you may have seen, Inside Out. Have you seen it? Yes? No? Well, those of you who haven't seen the film, I really recommend. It is amazing, not just for children, I have to say. Not for children. So I'm going to invite you to take a look and to observe and to watch and to inhale the film, and then I'm going to ask you some questions about the emotions that we have there, and we're going to be talking about these emotions. We're going to be working on emotions, and then I will go deeper and deeper in you, so you will have to explore yourselves. If you don't want to share, you don't have to share, because this is private, so we will respect at all times your privacy, but we are going to invite you to do this, because if we want to make sure that our children, our students, become familiar with their own emotions, are able to recognize them, are able to talk about them, first, we adults need to do this. All right?